Innovate, Venture, Inspire. Welcome to Startup Awards 2016. Thank you very much. Ďakujem veľmi pekne za váš potlesk. Thank you very much and welcome to Startup Awards 2016. I like the applause. It was very nice. It wasn't meant for me, I understand. It was meant for all of you guys. So one great and big applause for you guys as well. I'm very excited and I'm very glad that I can be here and also the viewers of Slovak television. It's a great opportunity to show you guys what the Slovak television can do. So one great applause for the Slovak viewers. Thank you very much. So ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Startup Awards. It's actually the sixth annual Oscars of young Slovak technology companies. Each year, Startup Awards brings together developers, artists, designers, scientists, executives, investors, policymakers, and the entire Slovak startup community. This year, I have some interesting news for you. The Startup Awards has grown older and bigger, spanning actually the entire, not very boring and not tiring at all, the entire day, and counting more than 1,100 registered participants. We are happy to see as many new faces and, of course, old friends and people who've been here the fifth annual Startup Awards, the fourth, the third, the second, and the first. So the winners, finalists, all of you guys, we're very glad that you can be here and joining us today. We have amazing talks, amazing discussions with the brightest minds of this generation. And I'm here as well, so thank you. It's a great honor and, of course, pleasure. So we will be dealing tonight with four major areas: digital, society, art and design, and science. Now it's time, of course, to showcase the best innovative companies of Slovakia in those same fields. Today, you will see, and it will be happening right here on this stage, you will be, you'll be seeing 12 amazing teams presenting in front of an international jury, which will select winners in four categories. The overall winner of Startup Awards will get the same prize as I get for being here tonight. 50,000 euros. I thought it was 100. Okay, 50,000 euros. That's some fine cash. And I hope you guys will spend it here in Slovakia, in this beautiful city. Throughout the event, you can use Wi-Fi. This is a breakthrough for Slovakia. We have Wi-Fi finally. It's also here. And you can use it. It's called SASK16. You can tweet, you can Instagram, you can Snapchat, you can do whatever you want. You can also look at my homepage, howtolookawesomelikeme.org, so you can find that and check it out. You, the audience, of course, you guys be selecting the winner of our special prize by voting on our Facebook poll posted on Startup Awards page. It will be posted at 7:30 p.m. tonight. Just go to startupawards.sk or on Facebook and vote, and you can, the winning team gets a Mercedes-Benz GLA. For a week. That's very nice. That's very nice. After the event, you can obviously use Hopin app or Hopin tablets at the registration. I think there are beautiful girls and beautiful boys, most of them beautiful girls. They will help you out with the Hopin app, how to get around in Bratislava. So, now the sponsors. It's very important. On the behalf of the organizers, I would like to express really big thanks to all all companies and guys and ladies and gentlemen that are here and made this actually possible. So it's a big thanks to our partners. So you can clap your hands after I say the partner. the Slovak-American Foundation. O2, ZSE Foundation, KPMG, Huawei, Tatra Banka. ESET, US Embassy, Synergie, Slovak Rail Company, Slovak Business Agency. BDO, Taylor Wessing, Mercedes-Benz, Majerník, and Mihalikova. Asi manželia, ale ona si nezobrala jeho meno. Ani moja žena si nezobrala moje meno. I suddenly switched to English, Slovak, I'm sorry. Main media partner, the Slovak television. And of course, big thanks to all our media partners, supporters, network partners who are working hard with us to make Slovakia innovated and innovative ecosystem that grows every year. That's excellent. Now, please, joining me on this stage is a very important personality of the IT business all around here. So please, welcome Peter Kolesar, the CEO of Neulogy, who will say a few words and will greet you guys. So, Peter Kolesar. Ahoj, Peter.
Thanks, Saifa. Good evening and welcome to Startup Wars 2016. Mr. President, Mr. State Secretary, Excellencies, Ambassadors, University Rectors, Scientists, Fellow Entrepreneurs, and Finalists, welcome to the highlight of the startup season in Slovakia in 2016. Now this is it. This is the largest startup and innovation event in the history of this country. We have come a long way since the first Startup Awards in 2011. And over the 5 years of Startup Awards, the event has received hundreds of applications from the most promising technology startups in Slovakia. And it is not only a group of enthusiasts having fun, although that's certainly part of the story. The event has already had direct impact on the economy as the finalists have fundraised over 11 million euro in capital and are already employing hundreds of people in Slovakia and abroad. Startup Awards has been in many ways the epicenter and the Oscars for the Slovak startup scene. And we believe Startup Awards had a profound impact on young people, motivating them to take risks and start their own businesses. And there are now tens, if not hundreds, of Slovak, young Slovak innovative companies waiting for their global breakthrough. And today, you will get a chance to see another 12 finalists pitching on stage and competing for the victory in one of the four categories and for the overall award worth over 50,000 euro. And the competition has been fierce. The largest number of startups in the history of Startup Awards have applied for this year's competition. So today, and I'm proud to say that, we have the greatest lineup of finalists ever. Now, we're not only the startup competition in Slovakia and one of the largest national startup competitions in Europe. Today, we have expanded the concept to cover three C's: conversation, competition, and celebration. And thanks to Startup Awards and the amazing network of partners and supporters throughout Slovakia, we have managed to put spotlight on Bratislava and on Slovakia and highlight its potential. And we do want to go further. We want to help attract our best and most talented Slovaks doing great things abroad back to Slovakia, and we want to become a gravitational force for ideas, brains, and companies from around the region. Now, we're well aware that none of the achievements in the past or plans for the future would be possible without the support of our generous partners, sponsors, and supporters. We value the support of our partners that have been with us since the very beginning and appreciate all the new sponsors that came on board this year. Now, thank you for trusting in our organization, and we certainly wouldn't be here like this without you. The broadcast of this event in the past 2 years has been viewed by almost 250,000 people on RTVS, our main media partner. Thanks to our partnership with RTVS, we could spread the word about the most innovative young companies to households across the country. So thank you, RTVS, for sharing and promoting our mission, and thank you for the hard work of your entire staff. And of course, all of this has been put together by the amazing, hardworking, and dedicated team of people that have put this together. They worked extremely hard over the last months. You know who you are. You can't be on stage, but you are the reason why there is a stage and why there are speakers on stage. So big thank you for your hard work. And now, let me welcome a very special guest for this evening, a longtime supporter of entrepreneurs and entrepreneurship, of startups and startup awards, His Excellency President Andrej Kiska.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, dear buddies. It's my honor and pleasure to be here with you tonight. You know, on my state visit, I always take to the plane young people from startups. And when we return back, I sit with them and discuss how is life, how is business, how helpful was this trip for them. Interesting thing is that for many of them, the best part of this trip is that they were together for 1, 2, 3 days. These young people from startups were together, sharing ideas, encouraging, and this, for many of them, was the best part of the trip. That's why I am so glad here, because you are here to share ideas, to give energy. Many of you, maybe you had a chance to listen to me speaking to startups, to young people. I always speak about readiness to fail. Readiness to fail and then to stand up again. And I always repeat that after each successful person, even in my case, after each successful person are many failures. And the success is always connected with many failures, and do not be afraid to fail. The second, what I always speak is humility. It is not easy, but it's very important to understand after months, in some cases even after years of hard work, to say, that was not good way. That was not good idea. And to have this power, to have this humility, to stop before you are too much involved and you spend too much energy and money and everything, it's very important. And the third thing, what I always try to point out, is moral duty. I am sure that it is moral duty of each successful person to help, to return part of the success back to society, to people. Many of you are successful. Many of you would become very successful. And this moral duty, this understanding, is crucial for our society, for our planet. But today I would like to point out two other things. First, I always love this discussion, what is startup? Investors, my son, my friends would say, you know, startups, that's something what can be very successful in 1-2 years, make million euros of turnover and be worldwide and so on. That's startup. But for me, as a president of our country, I pay my respect to any good idea which creates at least maybe one job, any new position. Each new job in our country is very, very helpful. And all of you who maybe have another plan for million of euros of turnover in 1 year, but you have just the idea of small business, all of you who create at least one job, you have my full respect and thank you. The second, what I would like to point out is my vision of our country. You know, Slovakia should be not only country which is pro-exported, oriented, interesting for foreign investors, but also the country where corruption has no tolerance, where sick people get first level healthcare, where our kids are being educated on world-class level. I have a vision that Slovakia is a country where empathy, solidarity, tolerance, humanity, forgiveness are the key words of our daily life. And looking at you, together with you, I am sure that we can do it. We can change our so beautiful Slovakia to real great Slovakia. Have a nice evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think we have a very nice president. I personally like him very much. He's a nice guy. We're very happy to say now, ladies and gentlemen, that the Slovak-American Foundation is our platinum partner this year. This is actually the third year that the foundation has been with the Startup Awards, and they are behind the main prize about which you'll hear more obviously this evening. The Slovak-American Foundation is a US-based nonprofit that supports the entrepreneurial ecosystem in Slovakia through its US Connections program that works with innovative Slovak entrepreneurs who want to expand to the US and A. I would like to welcome here on this stage Ms. Mary McPherson from the Slovak-American Foundation, the platinum partner of this year's Startup Awards. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I'll just help you with the microphone.
It's great to be back here. Again, where 3 years ago we did launch our U.S. or 1 year ago we launched our U.S. Connections program, which is a growth and opportunity program for innovative Slovak startups. We run this competition three times a year, and the prize of that program is $35,000 in cash and access to resources and connections in the U.S. for companies that are ready to enter U.S. markets. with the help of our group of Slovak selection advisors for the U.S. Connections Program, this past year we awarded prizes to four companies: Streamstar, Photoneo, Drone and Base, and Kick Resume, and they're all outside in our booth this afternoon. I hope you'll have a chance to see them. Our winter 2016 round is open now, and that will be open until the 15th of December, so we hope to see some of you in that. The prize tonight, and we're excited to give a U.S. Connections prize at the Startup Awards, and the prize tonight will be decided by the jury, who you will meet in a few minutes, and it will be given to the overall winner of the competition, who is seen to be best positioned to enter the U.S. market. And we'll work with Neulogy and the other partners to ensure that the value to the winner is achieved. And as I think you've, as Peter said earlier, that prize now with our contribution is around 50,000 euros. So that really is enough to do something for these companies. And the innovation that we hear, that we see here, not just tonight, but throughout our work here in Slovakia, is a testament to the talent and perseverance and drive of the entrepreneurs in Slovakia, and it's more impressive every year. And in that spirit, we are developing an additional U.S. Connections Prize that we will launch in 2017 that will be focused on social entrepreneurship and those organizations that are building civil society in Slovakia. While we're based in the U.S., our efforts here are supported by our selection advisors, who are, I think many of them are here tonight, Simona, and you, these will be names that you know, Simona Bubanova, Paolo Luca, Zdenko Horšek, Šimon Šiko, and Vlado Bužek. We also have on our board three Slovaks, Maria, my colleague, Maria Hirahova, Anton Zajac, and Peter Gajic, who support our efforts as well. And all of the volunteers that work with us, our work could not be done successfully here. So we congratulate all of the finalists who've made it tonight and those who were in the process, and we look forward to an exciting night. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Mary McPherson from the Slovak-American Foundation. Okay, now let's get to real business. We are here to select, actually, the Slovakia's top startups of 2016. We have, and I can assure you that we have great 12 finalists. We have four categories, and each company will present itself within the time limit of 3 minutes, followed by a 3-minute Q&A by our esteemed jury. So the selection criteria are innovation, market opportunity, team, business model, market traction, and pitch. Very interesting stuff. The responsible for selecting the winners are right here with us in the audience, so you will see their faces on the stage in just a few minutes. So please clap your hands, be enthusiastic. Please join them in welcoming here in the sunny Bratislava. So, ladies and gentlemen, Bindi Karia, former head of Silicon Valley Bank in London and of Microsoft Ventures, coming all the way from London. Max Kelly from Techstar London. Aaron Wagner from Gemini, Israel Funds in Tel Aviv. Blair McLaren from Active Venture Partners in Barcelona. Thank you very much, and please come up on stage. Good evening. Nice to meet you. Great pleasure. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Let's see. The first group of companies to present here are competing for first place in society category. You might be thinking, what is behind society? What is that? You ask the right question. Companies selected to be in the final should demonstrate a technology and business innovation with a strong social benefit. That's very important. This is how the organizers describe startups in the category. Social impact is what drives you. Technology means helping others. So think affordable internet, think Mother Teresa with an iPhone. Ladies and gentlemen, we need some applause for three society finalists. So, COrvus, Karmadilo, and STEMI.
So it's easy. It's a CorVus. Last Saturday. I'm used to work like from the noon till late evening. So this is my working time. So I don't wake too early, but then I can work quite a long time till the evenings. Hard worker. 5 years ago, I studied informatics. I was surrounded by good people. Why? The best one, I think.
Okay, so this is our friend Lenka. She has two beautiful children, but she can't see her family. Lenka is blind. That's why it's so important for her to have good connection with the world, to have feeling of safety, and to be independent as much as possible. To achieve this, mobile phone is crucially important in Lenka's life. But in 2012, we said goodbye to Simbi and keypad phones, and Lenka faced a new challenge, how to use touchscreen smartphone. The same problem can affect 235 million visually impaired people in the world, and elderly as well. In smartphones, we have a lot of great functionality, but when you can't see the screen properly, or you can't see the screen at all, then it's a problem. So we set this simple equation to solve this problem, and our result is CorVus. My name is Stanislav Sokol, and in next slides, I will present you our solution.
Good afternoon. I am CorVus, application set which makes Android smartphones accessible to blind and partially sighted people.
So CorVus introduced itself briefly, and I will add that in CorVus we always display only one element per wall screen, so it means it is no more important where you touch the screen, but only which gesture you perform. This way, blind people, they can easily call, they can write SMS, use recorder, audio player, lie detector, they can check mailbox, take notes, and much more. There are other solutions, but we are different. We introduce this unique conjunction of two approaches which are normally used independently. We are flexible software, and we have great scalability to different user needs. Today, we sell B2B in 3 countries, and we have sold 95 licensees. Last month, we won this Technology for Good prize in Impact Hub Bratislava. Our team, most of us, we have visual impairment, so we solve our own problem, and we have many years of experiences with ICT solutions for the blind. Our advisors, great people willing to change and share their world knowledge with us, thanks to them for that. We have positive feedback from Slovak Blind Union, from Masaryk University, from these international events, from our beta testers and satisfied users, which is the most important for us. According to our business case, we should reach break-even point in late 2017 and goals on our 3-year track to grow, to approach elderly, to raise our sales, and to get investment. So this is happy end mainly for Lenka, our satisfied user, and with better quality of life, thanks to CorVus.
Thank you for your attention.
Thanks very much for that. It's fantastic that you're doing this. Tell me, Could you give me a little bit more information about the competition? Because I have seen someone using exactly a similar solution in the UK. Could you give me just a little bit more why you're different and why you're going to win?
Okay. So what is unique about COrvus? We unify these two different approaches, which are normally used independently in our competition. It is a special environment and screen reader. Screen reader, it's something which get you access to standard Android environment. It's, for instance, Tollback. And special environment, it's something which is specially designed to needs of blind and visually impaired. And it is really very easy for them to use phone with this environment. And also we use our own experience because we are visually impaired on our own. Our main IT developer, he's totally blind guy, very experienced. He studied computer science and worked at Comenius University for several years. So this is also a very strong thing about our team, I would say. And we also are software. It means that we are not fixed to any specific phone, which other competitors do several or very often. So this is also one of our advantages. So we think that visually impaired people, they can also choose. So they will just take our software and they can install it on the phone of their choice.
Thanks.
Hi there. Thank you for your presentation. Could you explain a little bit more about how you reach, how you distribute your product to the users?
Okay. So we sell B2B to a network of international distributors. We use these distributors because they are experts in sales in their countries, and they are specialized in sales of compensatory ads for blind and partially sighted. So they exactly know how to approach our customers, our end customers, and they can also offer or provide appropriate support for these customers. So that's why we use these distributors, and they are also experts in like national conditions, so end customer, he or she can approach a kind of financial support system of the national government in that country, and these distributors, they can help to this end user to approach this financial system, just to make it more accessible for them to get this compensatory ad.
COrvus, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Big applause. And next up is Team Karmadilo.
Like, it's like vibes. Maybe on Tuesday. usually between 6 and 7 a.m. I don't know, maybe Fox. Alternative or electronic music? I think anything about health and into health. So I like to see the progress in this area. None. Honestly, it was the same me, but a lot stupider. A lot smarter, but same me.
Hello, everybody. My name is Matej, and I'm founder of Karmadilo. For the last 7 years, I was negative in marketing and really close to philanthropy. So I could on one hand experience how NGOs and charities are vastly underfinanced, and on the other, my needs as a marketer for relevant and affordable data. So during those years, I managed to find a huge gap in quality of marketing data corporations are getting and how they are disconnected from the audience. So regular market research companies are providing corporates with answers from professional panelists. But those professional panelists do not really represent general public or targeted audience of corporations. Moreover, these panelists are wrongly motivated by money and have no connections to corporate brands whatsoever. Solution we've created and called Karmadilo gives corporates direct access to socially responsible audience, our mobile app users. We did it by changing the motivation, making it right. We are not giving our users money, but they can donate their reward after completing a survey to any NGO or charity they love. This creates an interest and meaning to fill rather boring survey forms. A byproduct for corporations is connecting their brands with CSR and harnessing the power of engagement marketing. We collect our data through a mobile app in which we focus mainly on user interface and user experience. Donation process. After completing a survey, this is the place where Karmadilo makes its impact on society, making parts of marketing budgets into socially responsible ones, transferring the money where they are mostly needed, in hands of NGOs and charities. Our business model is comparable to traditional research companies, but we changed the rules, as you can see. We are trying to maximize the amount of money that goes to donations, leaving a smaller cut for us. A global revenue of market research was around $44 billion. So with even a small starting market, this gives us a reasonable revenue prediction. We tested our idea with NGOs, users, and corporates, all successfully, thanks to a great team of people with experience and all fields necessary to create a working product. Our timeline is based on getting first traction and improving app in Slovakia, then try to bring it abroad as soon as possible. So we launched our app a few days ago, so if you would like to donate money to NGO you like from somebody else's pocket, go ahead and download it. To confirm and outdo our milestones, we are looking for funds. And, well, this is the last slide, so this is Karmadilo. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm ready for your questions, judges.
So I just wanted to clarify, the people filling in the survey, they're doing it because the corporate is contributing to a charity, or I didn't quite understand that flow.
Okay, the flow is that, for example, if you are a user of our mobile app, you download it, you give us some information about yourself, and then a corporate will, through us, will ask you to complete a survey. After you complete a survey, you will get, for example, €1, and you will choose an NGO you like from the list and donate it to. So this will like give you a good feeling, you know, of being socially responsible and everything.
Okay, and so that money is coming from the corporate?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, thank
so
you.
So the money goes through our users to NGOs.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Can you say a few words maybe about how you recruit users and how you make sure that you have A, enough users, and B, the right kind of users for the different surveys that your customers will be looking for?
Okay. I'm sure that for the beginning, most of our users will be the socially responsible ones. You know, we are starting our promotion through Facebook, you know, just trying to keep it low. But later on, as the word will spread, I'm sure that we will educate more people to be more socially responsible, and we will get more and more users in our app. So we can actually upscale our sales and bring as much content as possible in the app. So we will start with socially responsible users, but trying to make more and more users into it.
And what do you know about those users so that when your customer needs a survey to be filled by certain parts of the population, they have the right kind of mix?
Yeah, that's a good question. So first of all, our users will sign in through Facebook or Google account, so they will be like the first set of information we know about them. There is also like an in-house survey. We will ask more information about them, so the gender, where they come from, what they are about, what's their education, etc. So like the basic socio-demographic questions. But later on, as will they go through more and more surveys, we will know them much, much and better. So we can exactly target those groups that will be interesting for our corporates or marketers.
Last question from my end. What's to stop, your key competitors like SurveyMonkey or Typeform from moving into this space? Because clearly they already have a lot of that corporate customer base. So how are you completely different to these guys? And why would they use you over one of those other apps?
So how we differ from the others, I think, is the combination of things. So one of them is the motivation. So we go through a good feeling that people donate their rewards to NGOs. Another one is the user interface and experience. So the way that app communicates with you as a user, giving you that good feeling you have in your pocket. OK, thank you.
Thank you very much. Karmadilo. Wish you all the best. And we're moving forward. Please give it up for Team STEMI.
It's really near because it's my son, Martin. It happens frequently, maybe last week. At 5, not the best. Over the last many years, I'm still a doctor, I'm a cardiologist. I believe I'm still doing the same job, at the same time, I would be happy if the application will be widespread in the world. I don't like people to play with dog in computer, and instead of going out to play with dog in the forest. I would say maybe a dog.
Hi.
STEMI is a mobile application intended for healthcare professionals and cardio centers. STEMI can really save lives of patients worldwide suffering from heart attack. Every minute truly counts when it comes to life and time after someone you really love gets a heart attack. How can STEMI help, and why you should listen very carefully? Because we are not speaking about any social media check-ins or Facebook likes, but real human lives and minutes that can make a difference between life and death. This is heart attack. The best way to save a patient is to open occluded heart vessel. While there are multiple hospitals in every country, only a select few have a cardio center. This is a patient suffering from heart attack. Ideally, he should be transferred directly to a cardio center. However, many times paramedics bring him to a local hospital to confirm diagnosis. This creates unacceptable time delays, which can be often fatal. This has prompted us to develop a mobile application, STEMI. STEMI enables immediate communication between cardiologists in cardio center and on-site paramedics. It enables graphical and voice consultation, so the cardiologist can quickly confirm the patient's diagnosis, and the patient is being transferred directly to a cardio center. Our application has various functions which bring it far beyond some generic MMS message. We have secured and anonymized data flow to prevent any leak of patient's data. Bottom line is that all these functions, as a result, decrease ischemic time or time delays, which in the end increase your chance of surviving. This year, we have acquired 3 clients in Slovakia, which means that at the moment, there are 52 EMS cars contracted and using our application in everyday clinical practice. We have also brought on 2 partners in the United States, which are using and testing the application at the moment. If we look at the maximum potential, there are 30,000 EMS cars in Europe and around 42,000 in the United States. Ischemic diagnosis by paramedics is a worldwide problem. Behind STEMI stands a strong core team consisting of 3 Martins and 1 Jan, with medical advisory by my father, Dr. Martin Studenčan. Can we calculate the cost of human life? If we wanted to give a rough estimate based on our data, we can say that saving 1 human life would cost, with STEMI, would cost €600. Although this is just the prognosis, what we know for sure is that time is out and truly every minute counts. Thank you, and ready for questions.
Again, great. I'm delighted that you exist. On your team, who has the medical experience to guarantee the quality of the proposition?
So the original author of the idea is my father, who is a leading expert in Slovakia on acute coronary syndromes. He's focusing on this topic for 30 years. He has traveled around the world and solved this problem in all continents, basically, and also in countries like the United States. So
that's a great answer. Well done.
Thanks.
Could you explain a little bit how you introduce the app into hospitals? Is it easy to use? How quickly can the team be able to implement it?
Yeah, so our clients consist on one side of EMS crews and on other side of cardio centers, so not so much with the hospitals. And intention of cardio center to use it would be, for example, to decrease the mortality rates, and for the other side to save gas and miles for paramedics, for EMS crews.
Is there much training involved?
It's quite straightforward to use, but in the beginning we have to give them some kind of introduction briefing. We show them how application works. We show it to cardio center and other side to paramedics.
Is myocardial infarction the first step? Are you planning to move to other life-threatening situations?
We've been thinking about it, yes. There is a possibility to, with our application, to manage, for example, strokes. But at the moment, we would like to focus on what we know best, myocardial infarction.
So there's a little bit of information here about your business model, charging 200 euros a year per ambulance. Is that true?
Can you please repeat the question?
Your price point is 200 euros.
Yeah, that's the average price our clients in Slovakia are paying. But of course, the situation varies from country to country, and we can ask for more in different countries. But that's the average. So we calculated the cost of human life based on that. If we wanted to cover whole Slovakia, where are 300 EMS cars, Slovakia would have to pay 60,000 euros. And based on our data, we can say that we could save 100 to 140 lives in 1 year, because the secondary transportations, it's approved that they double the chance for mortality. So you are twice more likely to die if you go through the local hospital. Sorry for
that. STEMI, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Wish you all the best. And ladies and gentlemen, we have the first part actually in the can right now. That's the part we call the society. And we're moving on to the next category. It's called art and design. Art and design, according to the organizers, should use technology to create art and use design and art in creating technology. It's very easy said. It's quite hard to do, but I think we have nice presentations in front of us. So, ladies and gentlemen, now we are going to hear from Biocultivator, Maguss, and Crafting Plastics, all competing in the category Art and Design.
Unicorn. Pan Radio. Yesterday. Five 40. assistant professor at the university. AI. I hope that successful innovator. Janine Benius. I can tell you.
Good evening, my name is Zuzana, and I am representing the team Biomimicry for Design with project Biocultivator. Our project is focused on city dwellers living in concrete jungle who desire to own at least their own little piece of small green garden. Imagine, what can these people do when they want to grow their own food while living in an apartment? Why are we often observing empty balconies and terraces in rich developed cities? Maybe because their balconies very often looks like this one in the picture. We try to find answers for that issue, and our solution is Biocultivator. By combining gardening traditions, nature's unifying patterns, smart technologies, and of course, art of design, we developed the innovative idea, Grow Your Own Balcony Bio. Biocultivator enables planting, composting, and self-irrigation in one smart self-sustaining device. In addition, it provides much more. For example, production of own energy, production of own soil, recyclation of kitchen waste, and production of own liquid fertilizer. The biocultivator works as a small ecosystem on the balcony. You don't need to water the plants. You just need to feed your worms in vermicompost with your kitchen waste and enjoy the planting. The whole cultivation is smart, and you can very easily check status of planting and compost directly on your smartphone. By our solution, we are targeting especially bio and eco-seekers, families with children, and enthusiasts of healthy lifestyle and sustainable technologies. We would like to reach them by our distribution channels, such as developers of brand new apartments, innovative agricultural businesses, and bio and eco shops and showrooms. We believe that our team can handle all challenges associated with design and development of Biocultivator. In 2015, we participated in Biomimicry Global Design Challenge, and we have been chosen as one of the best projects from all over the world. We became part of Biomimicry Accelerator program for 1 year, and we won People's Choice Award that convinced us that we are on the right way to develop our idea and to bring our ideas into real life. We identified our current partners and advisors, and this is the complete picture of our future financial needs, especially for next 2 years for our basic development process. On the other side, you can see also expected revenues based on our conservative business model. Currently, we are at the end of proof of concept phase, and we are capital seekers for proto phase and the serial production phase. We believe that with our solution, we are able to improve catering habits as well as relationship of people to nature and our environment. Thank you for your attention.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the technology inside that will guarantee that the plants in this thing will not end up like the plants you showed on the slide on everyone's porches?
Yes, we cooperated with Biomimicry Institute, and the whole product is bio-inspired. Our biological inspiration is taken from Texas horned lizard and its ability to collect water with its body surface from rain, fog, air humidity, or dew. And we have now a proof of the concept of new material that is able to transfer the water directly to the water tank under the cultivation pot.
And have you tried it already? Have you have enough data to maybe validate those assumptions, or you're just early on in the process?
Now we have samples of this material. We made them by laser engraving, and they are working. But we have to decide into the which part we would like to integrate this special material to really use it appropriate.
Thank you.
Could you maybe just explain how this differs from the vertical gardens that are also aimed at balcony or apartment.
Yes, vertical gardens are our competitor, of course, but they are mostly based on hydroponic technology. And hydroponic technology is based on electric energy and artificial nutrition. Our device is different. It works also unplugged on biomimetic and physical principles. So you don't need to use artificial nutrition because you are producing your own organic liquid fertilizer. You are producing your own soil by recyclation of kitchen waste. It works as a garden in a glass bottle. It is self-sustaining.
You've in the notes, it says that your first revenue will be in 2019. Why is that? Why such a long time before you start?
According to our assumptions, at the beginning, we need to make first 30 working prototypes and give them to our first adopters for testing as a part of beta testing process. And it is quite a long time due to the fact that we have to check conditions of planting during the entire year, from the spring, then in interior during the winter. So it takes a time. It is development process.
What cities are you targeting, I guess, as a part of this trial? Because there's so many different weathers in so many different cities. For example, in London, we see four seasons in one day. So where will this work best, do you think?
It will be part of our beta testing process. But it works on physical principles and about the balance of whole system. So the system is able to balance itself according to external conditions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ďakujeme veľmi pekne. And next up, please meet team Maguss.
I used to work from 9 to 5. Or no, actually, I used to work from 9 to 12. Tesla cars. Elon Musk. Beer. Not sure. I use Android, but now I incline more to iPhone. I was a student. I was a student of software development program in Denmark. Successful CEO. Perfectionist.
Hi, I'm Andrej, and I'm founder of Maguss. So what is that Maguss? It's a game. It's a mobile game. It's a mobile augmented reality game. It's the first mobile augmented reality spellcasting MMORPG on the market. And you can play it with or without an electronic magic wand. It's a game that builds communities. So which order would you join? Prove your skills in a battle against other wizards, or collect some ingredients and use them to brew potions. Get outside and feel the breeze while fighting magical creatures. Now, let's get back to the non-augmented reality, and I'll show you some numbers. Maguss game has been in development for more than 2 years, with a base in Denmark. We've got fully funded on Indiegogo in first 10 days, and in total, we have raised 220% of our initial $50,000 goal. Only the campaign itself was shared 65,000 times on Facebook, and that's besides all other media shares and coverage. We also got our infographics to the hot and trending topic on 9GAG with 17,000 upvotes. All that helped us with building our community, which right now consists of 15,000 social media followers and 7,000 email subscribers with really outstanding metrics. We also have a community forum that consists of 460 members that are testing our game in this very moment. There are almost endless possibilities to monetize the game thanks to the highly customizable physical product, in-app purchases, advertising, freemium model, and perhaps additional merchandise. This is our team. We are 9, and we are proud to have a very talented artist, a game designer that has used to work with Warner Brothers, grand prize awarded developers, among other awesome team members. Currently, we are in the closed alpha stage with 400 testers, and very soon, in about 20 days, we are moving to the closed beta stage, only for those that backed our campaign. And later on, in February 2017, we have scheduled our open beta release. Then after that, we should move to the official release, maybe summer 2017. Thank you. That's it.
So just, again, to clarify, I'm walking around with the wand outside and I'm exploring. So you're almost like a next generation Pokemon Go type of application.
Yes.
Okay. So in that case, I'd love to hear some of the insights you've gained from your closed alpha. What have you found from those users? And the reason I ask that is the numbers in Pokemon Go, for example, as you know, were astounding. But then I've been reading that they've been dropping off quite significantly and stickiness has been a real problem. So what are some insights you've gained that's going to help solve that issue?
Yeah. So first of all, the wand is optional. So right now we haven't shipped it yet. We have scheduled shipping for February 2017. So people don't have to run around with the wand if they don't want to. And regarding the feedback, some people said that it's far better than Pokemon Go because there is much more to do. And I think that's the reason why Pokemon Go hype has declined, because all you can do basically is catching the Pokemons and train them. I mean, it's a cool goal, but after a while, it gets bored. While in our game, we have more options, like brewing potions, getting better in various skills, and like many more dungeons, team building, and stuff.
So I actually wanted to ask the same question, but I'll build on your answer, as well as, you know, ask you to elaborate a little bit on the actual experience, how you blend in the physical realities and the digital experiences of the game. But when you summarize your alpha, do you have any numerical conclusions in terms of how many times per day people want to play the game, how many times they open it, how long they stay on every time, interactions among users? What are the key numerical findings maybe from the alpha?
We don't know that much, like how many opens and stuff like that. But we know that the retention after first day was 60%, and after second day it was 30% with new members. Retention, I'm talking only about those that played the first game. However, there were many bugs, and that's why the game wasn't playable at third day or second day, because we had to fix it and release a new version. And that's basically all numbers we know right now.
Maybe add a few words about how you blend reality with digital and how really the game works. It sounds really exciting, I have to say. When I saw it on the web, it's really, really cool.
So it's a little bit similar to Pokemon Go in regards to the map. So you have ingredients on the map. There are points of interest that are generated automatically. You can pick them up or defeat monsters and stuff like that.
We'll talk later.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was Team Maguss. Thank you. And please give it up for Team Crafting Plastics.
If I don't need to wake up, I don't wake up. One word, enthusiastic. I don't know, some crazy working horse. I love COrvus, so that would be great. Bach. Meaningful technology. When it's not technology for technology. Technology that divides people instead of connecting them. Yeah, I like to sleep a lot. I hope I will know what I want to do.
Hi, my name is Matej and I'm from Crafting Plastics. We all know that all that plastic we use each day harms our planet a lot. We use oil to produce it and the waste pollutes our environment. But we don't need to do this. There is an eco-friendly solution, bioplastics. Bioplastics are made from renewable resources instead of oil and can be biodegradable. So bioplastics could be really great, but right now their quality and aesthetics are just good for packaging, not really for products beyond packaging. We see a great deal of potential for product enhancement and expansion for bioplastics that we think should take place in fashion. We at Crafting Plastics want to become trendsetters in this area. So at this year's Milan Design Week, we have launched our first collection of eyewear from bioplastic materials. We have developed a processing technology to make beautiful bioplastic materials so that we can design sexy and stylish bioplastic products. We are working in collaboration with a team from Slovak University of Technology. So far, our material has great mechanical properties, provides unique opportunities in terms of visuality, and is also very stable. We are securing an exclusive global license to use this material in several product categories. Crafting Plastics is an international team of design, business, and marketing professionals. Our material development is backed by a team of Professor Pavel Alexi, and we are proud to have a great network of experts supporting us. Since we have launched our CPI wear this year in April, we've got featured in a number of top design and materials magazines. We also won several prestigious prizes, but what we have valued most has been the great public response at the fairs. People love our glasses when they see them, and when they get the background, they are head over heels. There is already demand from renowned concept stores and retailers from all over the world that we can start satisfying as soon as we start production. We would like to build Crafting Plastics as a brand of bioplastic fashion accessories. And there are many possibilities for collaboration with other companies. We are already talking to very interesting brands. In less than 2 years, Crafting Plastics has developed from a student idea to a startup with potential for reframing what bioplastics could become. We now seek seed investment so that we could start producing, and the next steps would be expanding our product portfolio and finding the right business-to-business model. I will leave you with this message from Leo DiCaprio. The time to build a beautiful and sustainable world is now. Thank you very much.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the IP and the protection behind this material?
So we have this great collaboration with the scientists to develop a special bioplastic material, but they are quite narrowly oriented on large industrial purposes. So we are taking this a step forward from packaging and some mass applications to really enjoyable consumer products.
So you've licensed the plastic from the IP owner?
We collaborate on the development. It originated at them, but we also have IP in the material itself. But then the production technology and the design know-how is only ours.
Okay, thank you.
And am I right in understanding that you want to be a design company? No? And you want to create products, or do you want to license the technology onto
Well, there are those two opportunities to become a brand, a trendsetter in this. And then we have all this technology in the background that we can use in other product categories. We would like to grow as a brand of fashion accessories made of bioplastics. And then there are other product categories where the technology can also be used.
And on, following on from that, what is the makeup of the team? How is the team set up? Is it tech guys or is it?
The team is made of designers mostly, and then there are great business and marketing professionals and the great material development in the network and very strong collaboration. We believe that designers are the ones who can connect all those dots. There is demand on the side of public. The world needs this. And there is great development in science, but designers are those who can connect those worlds to bring that great scientific development to enjoyable products.
How much does this cost compared to production of plastics from oil?
Compared to oil, this material is still so far a few times more expensive. In our product category, that doesn't really matter, as we are taking bioplastics to a category of higher value products where the price of actual material is a small percentage of what we are selling.
Can this material be used by 3D printers?
Yeah, definitely. We are working on that.
What is the actual process of converting? I'm not sure at any stage you talk that through.
This is our competition. We are not the only ones working on bioplastic eyewear, but in our very straight category, we would be the cheapest in fashion-oriented bioplastic eyewear.
Thank you very much. Crafting plastics. Ďakujeme veľmi pekne. Thank you very much. Now we are going through the digital category. The digital category is mostly about pure code, software, web, mobile, social. Think big data, dating apps. Ladies and gentlemen, a big applause for eDocu, Pygmalios, we found them, and Agent Balance, this year finalists of the digital category.
Basically hard to say when I work or not. Or if I work, for that matter. His name is Scratch. It's the little animal from Ice Age, which always brings something, puts it into, you know, the ground, and everything is destroyed. Yeah, what scares me are stupid things, because a lot of time there are stupid things invented and they have really big popularity. I probably don't admire people. No, I do. This is, sorry, Mom. I was a filmmaker. I was doing what you did, guys, what you're just doing. I don't know. It's really hard to say. We are startups. You don't know what's going to happen tomorrow.
So, hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Philip, and I represent eDocu. Before I start showing you all the cool hockey stick graphs and the big numbers, let me tell you a story about my good friend, Harris. One day, this happened to him. An alarm rang. There is something wrong with the welding robot in his factory. So, what Harris does, naturally, runs to the machine to fix it, right? He observes the machine, he looks at the machine, and has no idea what's wrong with it and how to fix it. So at this point, Harris is faced with two options. Option number one, go back to the office, go through the archives, look at the blueprints, talk to his colleagues, get the knowledge, get back to the machine, and start fixing it properly. Or option number two, to try his luck and improvise. Both of these options, they are bad options. They are killing time, they are killing money, and they could potentially harm my friend Harris, and I don't want that. Now imagine this story going like this. Harris gets to the machine, he scans the QR code on the machine with his smartphone, and he gets all the necessary information, data, blueprints, and knowledge right when he needs it. So when he has the knowledge, he fixes the machine. Once he's there, he does a work record and photo documentation, and he schedules a recheck for his colleague for the next shift. It'll be looking something like this. And this is a giant difference between having and not having eDocu in a factory. But there are different big and growing markets which are facing the same problem every single day. Now we know it, not because we are young and bright startupers, but because we have 72 years of combined industry experience. That means we have been there, we have done it, and we have suffered this problem. We've been tackling with this problem with our clients from Slovakia, Czech Republic, and now we are very excited to start working with an international client from Germany. Our pipeline is currently, well, at this point, it's more than 3.7 million euro. Now, as I said before, 2015 was our proof year. So we proved that what we do is helping. The problem is real, and the clients, they are willing to pay for what we do. Naturally, the next year for us is expansion. So we are going to be moving to different markets, the markets we know and we like. We're going to be launching a sub-product and definitely going to be looking for another line of investment. What's then? Sky is the limit, and we are ready to register every bird on the sky. So this is what I have to say for now. Thank you very much for your attention. This is eDocu, and what we actually do is we are linking things with information. Thank you for your attention.
You've also got some market validation. What's your sales process?
Well, what we actually do, we have, it's basically pretty simple. We have software as a service solution, so our new client doesn't have to have anything. He just pays and start using eDocu per user. Or it's for some of our big clients, it's on-premise installation. So it's a project-based model with SLA. And it differentiates from client to client because they are usually a bit customized.
In your clip, if I got it right, you're showing QR codes as the way to create some sort of communication between the machine and the back end. How do you see your company's role in a world where machines are continuously connected 100% of the time through online means all the way to the back end systems, collecting tons of data and analyzing it?
Of course. That's a good question. Actually, we are using QR codes, NFCs, beacons, and we can actually use even GPS. We call them iTags, so they are just shortcuts to information. And of course, we are ready to connect to the machines. We connect to SCADA, we connect to various different machines, because sometimes the machine can tell you what's wrong, and sometimes it's really good to have this information because you already can get the knowledge about how to fix it. So you know that, you know, for instance, you understand the error A327, right?
So are you creating a database of machine schematics, of user manuals, of error codes, or is each company treated independently?
Yeah, the point is, what we are creating right now is we are a platform. So this is a platform, and every single company enters its own data. But, of course, the future is once the same machine is going to repeat itself on and on and on, we have the manuals, we have the schematics, and we are getting to big data.
So you've got some good initial traction with those clients, but the actual end users of the products, so the people that snap the QR code and get the information, can you tell me a bit more about their rate of adoption, what has worked, what hasn't? Because ultimately, that's what's going to drive a lot of the success of what you do.
Yeah, this is really cool because they are not the ones paying for for eDocu. What we actually did is we created, especially for them, for the field, we actually created an app, which is Android and iOS app with giant buttons, so they can use it. Because they are usually technicians, they're usually pretty simple people. So we're getting knowledge and feedback from them, well, daily, because they always complain if something doesn't work, and we actually created something specially for them in the field.
What's the feedback been from them so far? Sorry.
I'll tell you in the after party, but it was cool.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
eDocu, thank you very much. And next up, from the backstage to the light, Pygmalios.
In one word? One word. so energetic. Blade Runner. Do I have to? Yeah. I don't know. street life. I'm optimist and I believe in a bright future. My family, I think it was my grandfather. Don't know, but I was completely different kind of person. I think almost similar today person, or the same maybe.
Hello, my name is Michael and I'm from Pygmalios. And we are going to disrupt the retail management as you know it. Did you know that there is 91% of global retail revenue in brick and mortar stores and only 9% in online or e-commerce? So why then there is thousands of analytics tools in e-commerce and just few or non-behavior analytics tools for brick and mortar stores? If you want to know the experience and the behavior of your customers in the brick and mortar stores, you can pay a really expensive expo service or mystery shopping, or you can prepare a subscription for 24 months in the same price or less to see this. All of this information, similar to Google Analytics on the website or any analytics tools on the website. Science fiction? Not. This is real. And we are already cooperating with biggest brands, biggest retail brands in Europe. How we are doing that? We developed a unique, completely new IoT platform with business value. We are receiving a lot of information from existing sensors, futuristic sensors, also the transaction data, buying data, external data, weather, holidays, and so on. We build it on the cutting-edge software technologies that Cure is so powerful that can learn and that can be your future best manager that you ever met or best consultant. This is our app. This is how it looks like. This is the 6,000 tracks of your customers, how they decided to go. Conversion rate per category, the completely new metric. Queue monitoring in real time. Stay time. How many people are in the same time in your stores. How many returning visitors do you have? But what is most important, you can compare every metric in one system with revenue, with transactions, with external data like weather and so on. Also, we can track the people that are crossing not your store, but in front of your store, in front of your window. This is our team full of inspiring people and two really strong mentors from CTO from the really big IT Slovak company, and Tibor from the retail segment. This is our software as a service business model. This is our partners for scaling, and we are ready to install it on the millions of devices around the world. This is our happy customers and real case studies, the big retailers, and we can be like Uber because we can install it in already bought cloud hardware worldwide, or spread inside the network with the big clients inside Europe. And what is it good for? It is good for retailers because they want really to tackle customer satisfaction and to make their customers happy, but they don't understand them in the brick and mortar stores. Thank you.
Interesting application in retail. Can you see this extending to other industries?
I didn't understand because it's echo.
So I see that you've applied this to IoT in retail industry. Are there other industries that you think this could extend to?
Yes, with that platform we are able to do that, to scale it horizontally and vertically also. But for now we are focusing especially on the retail because the retailers are blind and there is a huge gap and it is a big industry and that will be $19 billion in 2019.
And a quick follow-up, if that's all right. Competitors that you feel you have in this space?
Yeah, we've got a few with the complex solution, like the behavioral data, but really a few. And there are some particular solutions, but not the same complex solutions.
So a couple of questions. This is a working product, right?
Yeah.
Installed in live customers?
No. We've got a special integration system with our integrators around Europe, and also that Cisco and other hardware producers are connecting us to them.
No, but this is working today inside of actual stores.
Yes, of course.
So what can you tell us about your first one or two customers? What are the benefits they got out of it? Can you quantify it?
Okay, for example, the mango, the fashion, they are setting up the staff and they are improving the quality of service and they are optimizing the window because we've got a new KPI, for example, the window conversion rate or how many passerbys are converting to visitors, for example, the new KPIs. Then you can see where are the peaks of occupancy in your stores so you can make a stronger service like have a half-time, part-time staff. For another example, some of our clients saw the potential of the localities and they customized the opening hours to improve their revenue. Another example, but the biggest, is like it's really important when we are remodeling the huge network because you have to know if it is working or not and you can make mistakes for billions of euros. And it's just, real stories.
Just following on from that comment, one of the challenges here is accuracy. Can you explain how you deal with the accuracy?
Sure. For example, you saw that Trex is 1.5 meter accuracy. It's a location system based on Bluetooth. And we've got also the 3D cameras for the non-basket shops, for example. And the accuracy in one metric is really important, in one it's about the trends. But we've got a lot of possibilities of sensor already now, and you've got some on the tables. And there is also the chip on the mineral water, for example.
Thank you very much, Pygmalios. Thank you, and please give it up for Team Agent Balance.
Crocodile bites you down and never lets you go. I truly don't remember. It's days and nights, and I'm sorry to my family and everyone around. Yeah, my colleague's music, unfortunately, most of the time, so I don't know what it is, but it's terrible. Right now it's electric cars. Thinking of getting myself one of those when I grow a little bit bigger and better. I was just a hardworking guy, but now I'm a hardworking guy in a company that I love and is my own. Yeah, I'm gonna be working with awesome people on things I like and living with the people I love. One word, awesome.
Hi, my name is Przemek, I'm the co-founder of Agent Balance, a
software solution for call centers. I have a question for you all. Do you like calling customer support? I don't know anybody who does. But believe me, the agents, the operators who work there, they don't like it either. They're quite unhappy. Nobody understands them. People are rude to them, and that's why they have a high tendency to leave the company, right? And the solutions on the market currently don't really help because they only measure performance. So not why the people are leaving, but how they are performing. We have a tendency to change it because we provide understanding. We measure emotions, happiness, how people enjoy their work, and provide a new type of communication between the operator and his manager. So what is it that we really measure? We are able to tell how fulfilled people are by what they do, how much energy they have and where this energy is invested, how likely they are to leave the company, and on top of that, we provide consultancy what to do in certain situations in contact center. What does it really look like? Notice the blue line. That's measuring KPIs. At number three, the regular solutions on the market notice a problem. At number one and two, agent balance notices the problem. So we provide a lot of time to avoid three from happening. We can mitigate problems and drops in KPIs. How do we do that? CA method, a solution method based on psychology, statistics, and mathematics, and on associating colors and carefully chosen phrases. In only 5 minutes per week, we are able to get in the agent's subconsciousness and find out the parameters about them. Again, weekly, so we get a beautiful trend. Market is big. Contact centers are growing 20% per year still. There are a lot of nice companies on the market. They don't compete with us. When they see us, they want to correlate and integrate their data with ours. Proposition for the customer? Well, we will help you lower the turnover of agents by 10%. We'll save you a lot of money. What's happening right now with us? We have quite a few very happy customers. We are on our way to achieve our targets. We sell indirectly through partners on all continents currently. We have resellers who work specifically for us and with us, and we provide them with revenue from very, very interesting streams. The team, 45 years of combined relevant experience from the field that we are working in. Customers, they love us and we love them back. Some recognition, we were named the number one most interesting innovation for contact centers in 2015 by the professional community. Agent Balance, we'll be raising Series A in 2017, about mid-year. Thank you very much. It's an honor. I'm humbled. It's amazing. I'm happy to be here. All the Agent Balance crocodiles, I love you.
I saw that your my first question was going to be around what do you do once you have the numbers, but you mentioned the consultancy services you offer. To what extent do those consultancy services a requirement in order to meet call centers' needs, or to what extent are they a plus?
Thank you. It's a very good question. It's not a requirement, not necessarily, because call centers generally do have processes in place. So what we do is we help them optimize and make them more effective. We do not teach them to train their people. We teach them when and how to train the people with the process that they already have in order to make it as efficient as possible. Because without our data, they're pretty much blind. They do not know when to use these internal coachings and motivational sessions and product education.
So 2017 is the year projected to be the rise of the chatbot, particularly in customer center and customer service scenarios. How are you engaging with that new form of future?
Yeah, let it be. It's of course, it's the future. It will have certain impact on contact centers, but we are in for emotions. There will be an agent always present, and he will be reading what the machine tells him to read. And he'll have to incorporate emotions, or she will have to incorporate emotions. And that's where we come into play the same way, because we will be able to measure how engaged these people are, how likely they are to engage with the customer and make the customer come back. So chatbots, all right. But people, they will always be there.
So you've been installed at actual customer sites for a while, a year?
Well, yes, pretty much a year. It's, well, a little under a year with most of our customers.
What is the ROI that they expect? How do they measure whether they're happy with you mm-hmm. or not enough?
They see our data correlating with their processes. I'll give you an example of a live client. They had a manager leave about quarter a year ago. Within a couple of weeks, we could see a steep decline in the job satisfaction of the whole team because they just couldn't cope with the change and the new management wasn't able to catch up. So we told them, look what's happening. You need to re-educate your team leaders in order to pull it all up. That's exactly what they did. You know, you can't always measure in money, and that's why I'm using this example. It's all about quantifying things, also not on the monetary point of view, not in the monetary point of view. That was the agent attrition case that I had. That's saving a lot of money. But we need to talk engagement, love, and understanding in the contact center because it's very, very difficult to work there.
You're going to grow more than 10 times next year. How are you going to do that?
Well, we're going to utilize new types of modules in the solution, and we're going to grow even more rapidly in the regions.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
Agent Balance and their journey. Thank you very much. We are almost at the end, actually, of our competition, but we are not done yet. So last but not the least, the finalists of the science category. Please welcome last three finalists, AID, GroupSolver, and MultiplexDX.
Any technology development on embryo. That scares me a lot that we can actually in future just program aid, kids, whatever. I try to be funny all the time. I was a humble husband having first kid. Very different person. Long time ago, very long time ago. Neither. Slovak song.
Javorom, zeleným javorom, 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 zeleným javorom.
Hi, my name is Paul. I'm a co-founder of MultiplexDX, a biotech that wants to fight cancer. Cancer is a huge problem of entire society. Millions die consequently every year. But why we have so many therapies and drugs? Honestly, because no two cancers are alike, and we still cannot diagnose cancer precisely. When somebody gets sick and goes to a doctor, is often misdiagnosed and then mistreated by sometimes deadly chemotherapy, and this all due to bad diagnostics. We want to change this. We want to develop faster, more precise and personalized diagnostics that will actually save lives and will result in perfect and life-saving treatment. I give you an example. Patient A and patient B were tested by today's diagnostics. The results looked the same, and they were treated the same way. However, patient A died. Using our technology, we can immediately see that patient A is different, has an aggressive tumor shown by a green color, indicating also very high level of cancer marker. Yet, patient A was undertreated and required targeted treatment. Therefore, we have also developed an accurate and multiplexed quantification of biomarker. First, we quantify it by visualization and then by complementary sequencing. results are compared, cross-validated, and if fully agree, then we have the perfect clinical parameter to which targeted and personalized treatment is adjusted. That's how we want to save lives of the cancer patients. But we don't want to stop here. We are developing 3D visualization of biopsies, and this is a revolution in diagnostic field. Now we can detect cancer cells with super high precision, rivaling today's 2D diagnostics that cause often lethal false negative results. To reach our goals, we assembled a multidisciplinary team of 3 scientists and in combination of business. We all are PhD trained at the top universities, and we have 50 publications and 3 patents combined. We have also worked in the top biotech. That's why we know what to do to bring the perfect diagnostics to the market. We are not only about R&D, we have also created significant revenue, and our clients come from the most prestigious biotech and even universities. To bring our diagnosis to the market, we need 10 million euros from combined venture capital or grants, such as government or even our personal. I really believe, I'm sure, that we will develop novel diagnostics that will save many lives and will significantly increase well-being of entire society. And this will be indeed beginning of revolution in personalized medicine. Thank you.
Two questions. First one is this a blood test or a scan, or what is it that creates that incredible visual?
So this is actually a visualization of biopsy. So basically dead tissue.
Okay.
However, we can also do tests from the blood.
Okay. And then secondly is around the time to market. So the 10 million, how long will it take you to get to market with the test? And does that also include getting FDA and other EU approvals?
Yes. Yes, very good question. So it will take us 5 years to get validation of our diagnostic test. However, we have already created some revenue. So we have a lot of sub-products that actually can create some kind of machine to earn money. We know that you know, nobody will get us 10 million you know, while we don't show at least some revenue. But this is also important. While we are doing this, we also are creating a lot of good collaborations with clients, such as hospitals or even biotech nowadays. We have a very good project with one biotech where we are actually co-developing a sequencing kit.
On the actual way you reach the doctors, is it a technology platform that you're selling to hospitals, or are you offering a subcontracted service, so an outsourced service?
So actually both. So during the validation time, we will outsource doctors. We have a plan to validate breast cancer test, and we have actually very good contact to National Cancer Institute that two of us, co-founders, have worked previously. So we actually have been working with doctors for many years. And they have actually, this is a great thing about National Cancer Institute, that they have a huge network of other doctors. So if we reach one, then we can reach actually another, maybe 100.
The thing that's going to mean you're successful or not is whether you've got the intellectual property, first, that's different than anything else in the world, and then second, that's protected. What are you doing about that?
So, we have great expertise, as I showed. There are many companies, huge competition in biotech, but we have one unique expertise, which is the multiplexing, combining sequencing and visualization. And we are also working on our own IP. I have issued 3 patents. I'm co-inventor of 3 patents, and we also will secure it by buying licenses from Rockefeller University, where I worked before.
Can you say a couple of words, maybe, that we can understand about how you combine sequencing and visualization in order to create unique IP in the after party?
Yes. Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much, MultiplexDX. And next up is Team GroupSolver.
Thank you. my coworkers, and Elon Musk. My coworkers. High school. Wake up or get up? Wake up 7 a.m., get up, really depends. Awesome. A cheetah. Metal or ambient electro? Artificial intelligence. Second year at high school. Rich and successful.
Good evening. My name is Rasto Ivanic. I am the CEO of GroupSolver, an intelligent survey platform. But you can think of us as a survey monkey with a human brain. And we ask questions that many of you in the audience ask every day. What do my customers want? And to answer that question today, you essentially have two options. You can run a survey by yourself, or you can pay somebody to do it for you. But neither option is great. Do-it-yourself surveys can give you data quickly, but they're often shallow, and it almost takes a PhD to get them right. Now, you can hire a consultant and get the great insights, but it will take a lot of time and a ton of money. So we give you a third option that combines the speed of online survey with the depth of insights you need to run your business. Now, doing this is not exactly easy, but with a lot of ingenuity, a ton of tinkering, and data science, I think we cracked the code. Our secret is asking open-ended questions and getting a lot of information out of them. And we do so by combining crowdsourcing, machine learning, and advanced statistics. And here's how it works. People answer the question in their own words. And through collaboration, the best answers rise to the top. We then use machine learning to consolidate the answers and remove the noise. And finally, we validate that answer so that you can make a decision. You can make a decision for your business. So let me give you an example. We had a client whose product was not working really well, and he wanted to know what to improve. So we found his customers online, and they used our app to answer the question in their own words. And in the meantime, the client was using our dashboard to see the answers coming in. And really quickly, he found out that he needed to make a healthier sandwich with more natural ingredients. So speaking of customers, let's talk about business. We make money by selling individual studies or annual subscriptions. And we've been fortunate to work with some amazing clients that range from top market research firms like IRI to brands like Estée Lauder. And we have been growing. Since we launched, we grew at least 50% every quarter. But the best part is that customers love what we do, and they keep coming back. But I know we can grow faster, which is why we are raising an investment of $1 million to help us continue growing and scope our revenue and our product. We are GroupSolver. We have the talent, we have the passion, and the skills to win in the customer research space. And today, I invite you to join us on our journey.
I would start with a McKinsey thing. That's a key thing that you didn't mention early on. I would definitely push that more. But this is obviously a crowded space. I actually don't know what makes you guys different. So why are people going to choose you versus anyone else, including one that we saw earlier on?
Sure. There's three big reasons. And the first one is that we make market research much simpler because you can ask fewer questions using open-ended rather than running a long survey with a lot of multiple choice. That makes it cheaper and faster, not just to build the survey, but to analyze also. And the second thing, which is very important, is that because there's a lot of information in open-ends, in questions and answers that are coming from the top of your mind, which today I ignored. And there really is anybody else who knows how to do it as fast and as efficiently as we can. And that brings me to the third point, which is resulting is an amazing speed. We get hired all the time because nobody else can do this as fast as we can, which improves the speed to making a decision, which is all this is all about.
Can you tell me a little bit more about the technology and what part of it is patented?
So the patented is the algorithm that allows to combine multiple different answers from multiple people and finding where the intersections happen, and then create and use essentially statistical methods to find the correlations that together create a story from people that might have not even seen each other. It's a consensus building.
So when you say open-ended questions, then it's just free text that people answer with, and you have to analyze?
No. So we have a few tricks. When I say tinkering, there's a lot of testing. When we ask a question, we ask the respondent to answer in their own words, but we give them a little bit of a limit, about 100 characters. Now, they can enter as many of their own answers in 100 characters as they can, but at some point, those small chunks of data of text become data. And the second step of the answering process, which is different than anybody else's, you know, usually just write the answer and you go away, we actually start showing people what other people might have said. And we choose it using an algorithm to start building those relationships between different answers. So it becomes much more interactive. And we're using both a human recognition of the patterns, but also machine learning to get the best of the two worlds, because neither one of them by himself is now doing a great job.
So what can you tell us about your sales process? How do you get the customers, and how fast is the sales process?
It can be very fast. Usually when we call a potential customer through direct sales, which is 90% so far, we haven't invested in marketing yet, 80% of the time they either tell us, we have a project for you right away, or come back in a few months. And it can be, we had customers we talked to 3 months ago, 6 months ago, suddenly show up. But it's become predictable.
Thank you very much, GroupSolver. Thank you very much. And please give it up right now for Team AID.
They just fired me from my job. Yeah, and I got pregnant wife, and we got a big loan on our new house. It was a very interesting time. Artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence in guns and in military usage. I never worked such a short time. It depends from my three daughters. My family, my wife and my daughters, and my mom. Autistic. Yes, I leave my socks on the stairs. My wife hates it.
Hello, my name is Martin, and I came to represent artificial intelligence diagnosis. What we did, we developed artificial intelligence, intelligence which can learn anything. For example, we taught her how to distinguish between objects. This is a cat, this is a dog, this is a plane, this is a spaghetti carbonara. She can learn and she can recognize this is the object. And how we did it? We show her a lot of objects of the same. We show her a lot of cats, and she learned in 1,000 patterns, this is a cat on the picture. We got a brilliant results, and therefore we said, let's focus on something serious. And due to the fact that in our families we got the experience with the cancer, we focus on cancer diagnosis. The cancer diagnosis got a quite a good big gap. Today, the diagnostic is done manually. There are some semi-automation which are showing pathologists where he should look, but he has to do it. He has to check every single tissue. It's taking time, and one patient can take a day. And this is a question of death and lives, how soon you get your results. And there's a quite high level of error in surgical pathology. And if you got two good pathologists, in 10%, they will have a disagreement. We, with our artificial intelligence, we can check thousands of slides, thousands of tissue a day. The pathologists got a limit of 100, 120 slides a day.
We got a big strategic partner, the biggest labs or giant labs in the Middle Europe, who are providing us a lot of tissues, and we can learn what is a cancer and what is not a cancer. And they gave us a lot of histological examples to learn and to teach our artificial intelligence. And we got a 0% of false negative failure. So if there is a cancer, we always find the cancer. We got 1.4 where we think it's cancer and finally it's a healthy tissue, but that's not a problem. Our market is a big one, mostly the labs, but we can also focus on the third world. There is a complete lack of pathologists, and we can help them to save lives in the region where there is no pathology. From the money point of view, today the pathologists in Slovakia can produce 20,000 euro of revenue per month with us, because we can deselect the tissue, he doesn't need to focus, he can boost the revenue to 70,000 per month. And in America, it's going to be much, much wider. We got the competitors, we call them old school, the semi-automation guys, and there is a new age artificial intelligence in histology, and they are mostly on academic, in academic world, mostly in Harvard or University of California or Beth University in Israel. We have not found any commercial competitor. Yeah, this is our team. We got the analysts, we got the IT specialists, artificial network specialists, we got the pathologists, and we do our best to save your lives in the future. Thank you very much.
I've got a couple of questions. Have you, one of the issues with this, and I've worked with a company doing something similar, but for brain, for Alzheimer's, is just getting a large enough data set. Mm-hmm. How big is the data set that you've got from your strategic partner, and are you, mm-hmm. has it given you a level of confidence? Mm-hmm.
We have seen approximately 700 patients or 700 samples, and currently we're going to get all archives from them, because they do the labs, the lab work many, many years. So we're going to scan every single tissue in their labs, and we're going to compare with the results from the history, and then they will check if there's a discrepancy.
And how many do you think you'll need? Because when I was looking, when we were talking about brain scans for Alzheimer's, mm-hmm. it was about a million mm-hmm. brain scans. Mm-hmm. How many will you need to get the level of certainty that you require? Mm-hmm.
We believe it should be thousands. But then now we are opening a portal where we would like to get tissues from or scans of tissues from outside the world, because it can be also race-oriented. Now we got just a European market scanned, or Europeans, but it could be different for Latin America. So we are going to get tissues from other regions.
Final one was just on, you didn't have DeepMind on there, Google's acquisition of DeepMind, and they're doing work with the NHS in the mm-hmm. UK. Are they a competitor of yours?
I think they do mostly MR and CTs. They don't do histology. But definitely they should be a competitor. What we do, we are building our own infrastructure to learn the artificial intelligence. We are setting our own machines based on GPUs, graphical process units, and it's quite cost effective, and we're distributing the mathematical models across the GPUs. So we are in better budget than the Google kind of machine learning environment.
Can you explain a little bit your commercial strategy towards...
Yes, I have a slide for it. We sell a product to lab, so you get an automated scanner, we go through all the pictures of the histological samples, and we're giving you results. There is a cancer, there is not a cancer, so the pathologist is focusing only on the tissue he needs to focus. We are selling product. The product we can speak about 100,000 and up for installation. We're taking a percentage from every scan, and we can scale our business, because there is a thousand type of cancer. So today is lymph nodes, tomorrow is melanomes, afterwards you have a breast cancer, and also the performance. You maybe need 10,000 scans a day, but later on you can go for 15,000. So we can scale it vertically and horizontally too.
Can you tell me a little bit more about you and your background?
I studied automation and robotics. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. AID. And this was actually the last presentation in this category, and actually overall it was the last presentation because this was a science category. Last part of our evening, we will now see a special presentation by winners of this year's, and I love this, Innovation Kid or the iKid program, who have been a part of Startup Awards for the past actually 4 years. They usually beat everyone else's presentation except for mine. And this year, I'm not having any presentation. This year, please welcome on stage, all the way from Košice. It's a long way. But we love Košice, and we love the WashDog team. Here they go.
Poďte. Jo, čaute, ja som Karin, toto je Babu, Sofie, Kiko, Samo a Marko a prišli sme vám predstaviť náš startup WashDog.
Lebo na svete je viac ako 37 miliónov psíčkarov. Viac ako 80% z nich má psa v byte alebo v dome. A viac ako polovica z nich dovolí psovi voľne behať po izbách. To sa bavíme len o dnešku.
Hipsterov máme už aj v Košiciach. A to čím ďalej, tým viac. No a každý hipster potrebuje mať psa, že vraj.
Startupisti už v kanceláriách psov majú. Keďže dobré veci sa šíria rýchlo, očakávame, že o 2 roky každá druhá firma povolí psa v kancelárii.
A pointa? Čísla z úvodu budú rásť a stále viac a viac ľudí čakajú veľké problémy.
Aby sme nemali znečistené koberce a nábytok, musíme dostať vsadovanie a udržať ho tam, lebo má strach zo sprchy, vysušiť mu laby, umyť vaniu od špiny.
To vo väčšine prípadov znamená ešte viac špiny.
Ročne nám to zaberie okolo 500 hodín. A veď už len spotrebovaná voda nás stojí 170 eur ročne.
My sme 170 eur ročne znížili na 17 eur a to ani nehovoríme o ušetrenom čase. Čiže nemusíte umývať vaňu a sušiť uteráky. Čiže vás váš päť bude mať ešte radšej. Marko vám povie, ako sme to dokázali.
Náš prototyp tvoria dve nádoby. Do vrchnej nádoby sa postaví pes všetkými štyrmi labami. Cez túto hadicu pôjde voda z vodovodu do týchto trysiek a osprchuje to psovi laby. Vzduch z vysavača alebo z kompresora pôjde do bočných trysiek a osuší to psovi laby. Na spodku nádoby je rošt, aby pes nestal v odtýkajúcej vode. Kryť je tam na to, aby voda nestrikala von a aby sa pes nebal vody. Spodná nádoba je na špinavú vodu.
Na internete sme našli konkurenciu. Powash a Powboss. Powash slúži na umývanie jednej laby vodou, ale laby musíme sušiť uterákom. Powboss slúži na umývanie jednej laby vodou aj mydlom naraz, ale laby nevie sušiť.
Náš WashDog toho vie ešte viac. Umie všetky štyri laby a pohodlne a zároveň ich aj vysuší.
WashDog budeme predávať psíčkarom, ktorí chovajú svojho psa v byte alebo v dome. Aby o nás ľudia vedeli, vytvorili sme si vlastnú facebookovú stránku. Chceme skúsiť aj veterinárne kliniky, psie hotely alebo miesta, kde majú psi povolený pobyt. Pár kusov vystavíme aj u veterinárov a v pet shopoch. WashDog budeme prezentovať aj na výstavách psov.
WashDog by sme chceli predávať aj cez náš e-shop, ale to by nám zvýšilo náklady. Takže najlepšie bude, ako budeme predávať iným predajniam alebo skladom a oni ho budú predávať ľuďom priamo po kusoch.
V prieskume nám 100 ľudí povedalo, že by za WashDog dalo priemernú cenu 100 eur. 50 eur nás stála výroba a 10 eur nás približne bude stať preprava. Zisk za jeden kus nám teda zostáva 40 eur. Na trhu nás teda čaká 1 miliarda 200 miliónov eur. Sice je to dosť. Ale predpokladáme, že každý psíčkar si bude potrebovať kúpiť WashDog len raz za 6 rokov. Zakladali sme na kvalite, takže na nové trhy musíme expandovať dosť rýchlo.
K aktuálnej verzii by sme chceli pridať zásobník na šampón alebo balzám a cirkuláciu vody medzi nádobami chceme vymeniť, a vysávač chceme vymeniť za kompresor. A keď sme už pri tom, tak by sme chceli vymyslieť aj verziu do vesmíru.
Našu expanziu by sme radi opísali detailnejšie, ale
musíme počkať na výsledky od Elona.
Počúvaj, odpísal ti ohľadne tej novej timeline? Podarajú sa im to konečne dotiahnuť?
Jasné, písal. Potom ti to poviem, tu fakt nemôžem.
No, poďme späť k tomu, čo môže byť zverejnené. S prototypom WashDog sme vyhrali iKid Startup Awards 2016 a v septembri sme ho odprezentovali v dublinských centrálach Facebook a Google. Za toto môže náš tým spolu s našimi mentormi.
Trochu neskoro sme prišli na to, že vraj sme si mali zadefinovať role CEO a tak ďalej. Ale na tomto startupe sme makali. Ale na tomto startupe sme makali všetci rovnako intenzívne a tvrdo a nemali sme čas na také maličkosti, ako sú pozície a tituly.
Takže toto je náš tím spolu s pani učiteľkou Monikou a mentorom Stanleym, ktorým sa chceme poďakovať za pomoc a veľkú podporu počas celého trvania projektu iKid. Ďakujeme za pozornosť.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure and great honor to welcome on this stage our very special guest. I don't know how we deserve this, but I mean, Christmas is just around the corner, so probably it's our Christmas present to you guys now. The name of our key host speaker is Uri Levin. I think the name is well known in the community of you guys. It is one of the world's top advocates of entrepreneurship. He's living in Tel Aviv. He came here to Bratislava. Thank you very much. And he is the co-founder, or he's the guy who co-invented Waze, the world's largest driving traffic and navigation application with more than 200 million drivers around the globe. In June 2013, a small company called G-O-O-G-L-E, Google bought Uri Waze for more than $1 billion, making actually the biggest startup exit in the history of Israel. So that's a very interesting thing. After Waze, Uri co-founded FeeX. FeeX helps find and reduce hidden fees on financial services and addresses a problem in the size of 600 billion people in the US alone. FeeX allows users to recover hundreds of thousands of dollars and their retirement and long-term investment plans. Sounds very interesting. So I'm thrilled that we have him right here. And please, Bratislava and Slovakia, please welcome Uri Levin with a great round of applause.
Good evening, everyone. I can actually barely see you because of the lights, but I assume that you are there. So make a little bit of noise, so I will make sure that you are there. Okay. So I'm excited to be here, and in multiple reasons. One of them is that this is my first time here in Slovakia, and I like to be and see new places. And the other one is that turns out that Slovakia and also Czech Republic and a few other countries were actually the first countries that Waze was successful back in 2010. And so I already met earlier today a few of the really early users of Waze, and this is really exciting. In addition, I met your president last night, and I have to say that I'm impressed, and I think you are lucky that you had such an impressive person as a president, and hopefully this president will take this country into a new level and make great things, and it's always about making an impact. So what I would like... So what I would like to do this evening, and I also realize that I'm the only thing that's standing between you and the party, and I think party is, by and large, much more important than what I have to say. So I'll try to cut it short, but I'll tell you the story of Waze and a little bit about the passion of entrepreneurs, and most of the people here, I tend to believe, are entrepreneurs, and that's going to be pretty easy for you to realize and relate to what I'm saying. And maybe a few tips that will help you to make less mistakes in your startup than I did in my journey. So hopefully the slides are okay. So because I don't see my slides, but they are over there. So this is good. So in a lot of cases, you know, when you are an entrepreneur, you start with a very very strong emotion at the beginning. Could be love or could be hate. So I hate traffic jams and I hate waste and I hate to feel like an idiot, right? So every time that I will run into a situation that I feel like an idiot, I probably will go ahead and do something about it. And immediately after that, you develop the passion for a change and you start dreaming about how the world will be different if you're actually going to make a change, if you're actually going to make a you know, start this journey, start this startup, and make the impact. And part of it is the realization that you will need to sacrifice, and the startup journey is a roller coaster. It goes ups and downs and ups and downs, and to a certain extent, I would say, if you don't like extreme sport, then maybe startup is not for you. But in that sense, you know, the ups and downs are part of the journey, and they are dramatic. And at the same time, there is no doubt what's next, right? So if you would ask a startup guy, okay, so excellent, so you're building this startup, and what exactly are you going to do after that? It's always the next startup. And in most cases, they actually know what the next startup is all about. And so we formed Waze in 2007, and we launched the service in Israel at the beginning of 2009, and I already knew what my next startup is all about. And to a certain extent, I would say that building a startup is exactly like falling in love, right? So imagine that you have a lot of ideas and you think about it, and then eventually you pick one and you say, this is it, right? Or you go to many dates, and eventually you pick one and you say, she is the one, right? And then a little bit of time that you spend with the idea and you think about it by yourself and you don't tell anyone else about it yet because it's too fragile and too fresh, and you start to build the confidence, and then you realize that, okay, I'm feeling pretty good about that. So you're going to tell your friends about your idea, or you take your date to meet your friends. And this is where people tell you, it will never work, right? So if you are an entrepreneur and you heard that, raise your hand for a second. So no one ever told you that it will never work? Or this is the stupidest idea that I ever heard. You know, and I heard those so many times. And or they're telling you, this date, she is not for you. And this is where you disengage from your friends. This is where you stop listening to them because you're actually in love with what you're doing. And if you're not, then keep on searching. Keep on finding the one that you actually worthwhile of spending, to a certain extent, the rest of your life with this concept, with this problem that you're trying to solve. And the journey is pretty long, and it's long, and in particular, the longest part of it is the one that says lack of traction, right? So at the beginning, you know, you launch the service, and maybe someone writing on you on the newspaper, and you feel very excited, and you're actually making a progress, but then you realize that users are not coming, and those that are using it are actually quitting very fast, so you're not creating any traction. And imagine that this is like trying to cross the ocean with a rowboat, right? So you row all day, and you make very, very small progress. And when you go to sleep at night and you wake up in the morning, you are actually in the same place. You don't make any progress. You actually do, but you don't feel like you're making any progress. And this is the hardest part of all the startups. So getting from the point of view that you are very, very excited into actually creating the traction. Now, to a certain extent, this journey is a journey of failures because you try to go someplace that no one went before. And so, you know, we think we know, but we don't. And so what happens is that we try something and it doesn't work, right? And so we try something else and it doesn't work. And eventually we figure out something that does work, which only buys us the ticket to move to the next phase of the journey. So if the first phase of the journey would be product market fit, then the next phase of the journey would be, okay, so how do I scale that? And the next part will be, so how do I monetize that, and so forth. And in every journey is a journey of failure. So to a certain extent, if you're afraid to fail, in reality, you already failed because you're not going into this journey. And you know, part of the journey is celebrating a lot of things. It's actually deserved to celebrate a lot of things. So you celebrate the first user, the first time that you launch, the first 1,000 users that you get, the first time that you get into a new office, the first time that someone writes on you on the paper. You celebrate a lot of things. Much better than that is when someone is suing you for patent infringement. That means that you're starting to make an impact, that someone cares. And by the way, when it happens, and actually one of my startups, the CEO called me 2 months ago and said, we got a letter of cease and desist from a large company, and I'm about to open a bottle of champagne, and what do I do next? And so so I came to the opening the bottle of champagne, and then I told him that, you know, if someone is suing you for patent infringement, then what you do, you immediately sue them back. And now we are on common ground, and we can start a dialogue. And by the way, this will be consistent, right? If someone hits you, hit him back, and then you can start a dialogue. Much better than that is when people actually come to you and say, thank you, you helped us. And then you know that you have created value. And part of the reason that I'm always trying to build consumer services is because I get the opportunity to actually speak with the users and get their perspective and get their point of view, which makes me eventually much faster into the market and much faster into a better product. So let me summarize the journey, and it's very, very simple, right? What we are looking for is a problem that is worth solving, the problem that the world will be a better place if the problem disappears. And then what we're looking for is who are the users of that problem, who actually have this problem. And what we're really looking for is their perception of the problem, because we tend to believe that we, you know, we have this problem and therefore we understand the problem. And we are an excellent sample of one person. This is it, right? So really, in order to understand, we need to speak with other people and to see how do they perceive this problem. And only then we can build a solution, because otherwise we might end up with a solution that is actually looking for a problem. And this is not valuable, right? If you solve a problem, if you solve a real problem, you actually create a value. Now, if you solve this problem to a lot of people, then you create a lot of value. And I think this is the essence of what we are trying to do. All the entrepreneurs are trying to make an impact. The biggest impact is that if you figure out this is a big problem that I'm going to solve, a lot of value to a lot of people, definitely something that's worthwhile of doing. The Waze journey, and this is a little bit of magical journey, in particular because when we introduced the concept at the beginning, this is where people told us that it will never work. And when we started, that was the map of Tel Aviv when we started, blank page. That was the map of Bratislava when we started. It was completely blank page. And when the first driver drove, we collected the GPS data from the device, and if we will draw that on this blank page, it would look like that. Now, if we take that from a lot of drivers, it's starting to look like a map, right? If I will tell you that this is a traffic circle in the middle, it is a traffic circle in the middle. And if there is an intersection that no one is making left turn, then no left turn is allowed, right? And if there is a road that there are 100 people going into one way, and there is no one else coming the other way, that will be one-way street. And if there is a road with 100 people going one way, and only few coming the other direction, that will be one-way street in Tel Aviv. So this is how we drive. If you come over, please take that into consideration. Now, if you are a software engineer, and you look at this data, and I would ask you, can you build a system that actually generates a map out of that? You know, as software engineers, if you can imagine that, if you can describe that, then we can build it. And this is exactly what we did. We built a server that takes all of this data and creates the map. And the map by itself is not complete because it's only, you know, generating the roads and the intersections and the turns and so forth. In order to make it complete, what we need is actually street names. And so we enabled map editing tools that allow people to provide us with street names and house numbers and points of interest and additional information to make the map complete. Now, at this phase, if we will have someone that is driving slow, then we can figure out that there is a traffic jam, right? And if we have a lot of those all over, then we can figure out where all the traffic jams and actually help people to avoid them and get to their destinations the fastest way. And this is really the essence of Waze, a social network for drivers that we, the drivers, helps the rest of the drivers to fight traffic jams and speed traps. So this is how Waze works, and it turns out that it's working beautifully in a lot of places, and it turns out that one of the first few places that it works was actually here in Bratislava. And so what we are seeing is, you know, in this video, beginning of 2010, how the map was created in a few places. This is Bratislava. It will zoom in into the center area of Bratislava. A couple of more interesting stuff. So this video was created by someone that I don't even know whom, and hopefully this someone is actually here in the audience. But it was someone that actually made a snapshot of the map day after day and eventually combined that into a video. Now, if you drive someone somewhere, I assume that you can figure out where exactly is that. When it was the map of Tel Aviv, I could figure out exactly where is my house and so forth. If you drive someplace that no one drove before, then your avatar changes into a roller steamer, and you pave the road as you drive. And this is really exciting because you create something new that is not on the map, and this something is being used by everyone else the next day. So the journey is it was relatively fast comparing to startup life, but it was very, very intense. So essentially, it was started in 2006 by Ehud Shabtai. Ehud Shabtai, the CTO of Waze, started the concept of we can actually have an application that creates the map as we drive. And that was the initial concept. The idea was we can build a map of Israel, and that was running on a PDA. PDA, remember what it was? So, you know, long time ago, dinosaurs, PDA, Nokia phones, and this is where we are today. Now, this is a scary observation, right? This is less than a decade ago, and some of the technology has already disappeared, right? And today, everyone has either an iPhone or an Android phone. But if we would be here 10 years ago, then that everyone would have either a BlackBerry or a Nokia phone. And if we will, you know, do fast forward 10 years into the future, then it's very likely that we will have different devices, right? So not necessarily iPhone and Android, could be something completely different. And this is the pace of innovation. This is how things change dramatically. Now, if you really think about it, about half of the top technology companies will cease to exist in the next decade, or at least will lose their leadership position. Now, we don't know which part of the half, because if we would know, we will sell short on them, but we don't know. And they will be disrupted by startups like we have seen today and other startups that are not even exist yet. And so if you look back, you know, 10 years ago, there was Facebook, but it was insignificant. And 20 years ago, there was no Google, right? So many things have changed over the last years, and the pace of innovation is increasing. So in 2007, we met, and we decided that we're going to build a company out of that, and we're going to make it, instead of running on a PDA, we're going to make it run on a smartphone, so we can collect the GPS in real time and figure out where traffic jams are, and as a result, focus the entire service not on navigation, but on commuting. So every day, people are using Waze in order to go to their office, right? They know how to get there. But what they're missing is exactly what's going on the roadways. And we started to, speak with investors, and we created the story. We created the DNA of the company. And then we met a lot of investors in Israel, and they said, no. And no, and no, and no, and a lot of no's, right? So someone during this period of time told me that investors have 100 different ways to say no, and I heard all of them. I heard all 100 different ways to say no. And in reality, you don't give up, right? You don't give up because you have a dream, and you simply don't give up. And then in 2008, we were able to raise funds, and we started a company. And we started to recruit people, build a team, build the DNA that we wanted, and build the first version that was running on a smartphone. And it was running on Nokia at the beginning. So remember dinosaurs and so forth. Nokia phone was the first version, 2009. We launched the service with Nokia phone. And later on, we launched the service in the rest of the world, and only then we came into 2010, and we realized that we have actually lack of traction. So there were a few places that it turns out that the model works. So Israel was the first one, and then here in Europe, actually, we had Slovakia and Czech Republic and Latvia that it turns out to be working, and a few places in Latin America. But the rest of the world, it simply didn't work. It was not good enough. And the problem is that, you look at something that it's not good enough, and you measure everything, and you speak with the drivers, and you understand what doesn't work, and you go and build the next version which solves everything, right? And you launch that, and you know that this is it, and it's not. And it's not good enough, and you actually have to go iteration after iteration until you make it good enough. And every time you realize that this is not how you do it, and you make small increments in improving it to get to the level of good enough. Now, in 2011, turns out that we are actually reaching the good enough level, and we are reaching critical mass in multiple places. And it started in the US, in Los Angeles first, and San Francisco, and Atlanta, and Washington, D.C., and one metropolitan after the other. And in Europe, it was Italy, and Netherlands, and France, and Spain, and Sweden, and one country after the other, that we reached the critical mass and become good enough. Now, good enough is critical here. Good enough wins. The biggest enemy of good enough is perfect. You don't need to be perfect in order to be successful. You need to be good enough. So imagine this story about these two guys that are going on a safari in the jungle in Africa. And in the first couple of nights they spend on the camp. And then they say, let's do something that is very different. Let's sleep outside the camp in a tent. And in the middle of the night, there is a roar of a lion. And so they woke up, and they are pretty scared. And one tells the other, what shall we do? What shall we do? And then the other guy says, let's run. And then he says, OK, good idea. And he's starting to put on his sneakers. And so the other guy tells him, are you nuts? Do you really think you're going to outrun the lion? And say, no. I just need to outrun you. And this is critical, right? If you're starting to build something, and you're looking for perfection, there is going to be someone else that will be good enough and will capture the entire market. And by the time you will be perfect, you will be irrelevant. And that was good enough was for us 2011, 2012. Actually, Waze was growing faster than the entire industry together. And this is where we knew that we actually cracked the thing, and it's going to end up pretty for us. In 2013, Google shows up with a proposal to acquire us, and we simply said yes. Now, at the time, that was the biggest amount ever paid for an application. That was the biggest amount ever paid for Israeli startup in the consumer space. And we thought that this is, you know, this is the sky, right? So you don't really know where the sky is unless you try to reach there. Today, you know, Waze is probably 5 times bigger than it was in 2013 and probably would worth much more. But you don't know that when you make the decision. So this is really making the Waze journey rather short. I think this is these are critical, right? These are, for Saint, I would say, the summary of all of my failures or all of my mistakes into a single slide. So understanding who the users are and what's their perception of the problem. And in many cases, people ask me, okay, so if the first user of Waze, there was no map, so what was the value for the first user of Waze? And the real question should be asked differently. Who was the first user? And the first users of Waze were people that was actually their hobby, right? They care about GPS, they care about maps, they care about GIS. So for them, I was a tool, so I was looking for the enthusiastic amateurs at the beginning. And not regular drivers. The everyday drivers came later. Because if you're a regular driver and you would use Waze on the first day, you would quit using that on the first day. And so who the users are and what's their perception of the problem? Making mistakes fast. You know, to a certain extent, I always claim that product development starts after you launch. Before you launch, you build something in the lab, and this is very, very interesting, and this is, you know, you kind of express your own impressions. But you only start learning after you launch. Only then you get feedback from real users. And you should launch faster. If you are hesitating, if you think that there are more things that you need to do before you launch, you're wrong. You should launch. You should launch yesterday. You should be embarrassed with the level of the product that you launch. It only has to do, you know, at the end of the day, one feature or a couple of features. And you can take the example of LinkedIn. So LinkedIn, when they started their service, they had management meetings trying to figure out, okay, this is the roadmap. And eventually they came up with 30 features. And then they say, no, 30 features is too much. We need to reduce that. And they reduced that to 20 and then to 10. And they said, we cannot launch without those 10 features. Now we are more than 10 years later. How many of those 10 features were actually implemented? One. And this is critical, right? So start with something so you can actually start to collect information, collect feedback, and move faster. The DNA of the company and the mission that you have is actually defining the journey. And, you know, the day that you start, you think of the mission, you think of the problem, you basically say the world is going to be a better place if I'm successful, and this is all goodness. But the same day that you start, you're also starting a working place. And it's up to you to decide what kind of working place you're actually going to have. And so imagine what is the best working place that you can imagine. And build it in such a way. So you actually have created values not only by what you're doing, but also by how you're doing that. And what is this working place? And this is amazing, because we built Waze. We said it's going to be the best working place we ever had. And we did that constantly, or I'm doing that constantly in each one of the startups that I'm building. They are unique in their perception or in the way that they are building the working place. Fall in love with the problem, not the solution. As long as you are thinking of the problem, you're very much likely to solve it rather than being focused on the solution. So if you're really in love with your own solution and the problem goes away, you're stuck with the solution. If you fall in love with the problem, if you remain focused on the problem, if you claim ownership of the problem, you're in a much better position to solve that. focus, you know, my t-shirt says the main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. Focus is very, very challenging for a startup. In most cases, it's very easy to lose focus, right? Because you are in the lack of traction phase, and all of a sudden there is someone that says, you know what, if you'll do that differently, or I'm even willing to pay you if you will do a custom-made solution for me, and you end up as a project company rather than a product company. Focus on the problem you're trying to solve. And the last one is very interesting. So, So I have five kids, and one of them is 22, just get off the army half a year ago and started his first startup, which obviously makes me proud. And after a little while, he figured out that one of the co-founders does not fit. And he asked me what to do, and I said, look, eventually you are going to fire him. And if you'll do that tomorrow or in 2 months, it doesn't really make any difference. And eventually he did. And then we were looking for another co-founder to join the team. And I interviewed about dozens of co-founders that all of them were had a previous startup that failed. And I asked them why. Why did it fail? And half of them said because the team didn't fit. Now, by itself, it's not surprising, and it makes sense, and we are all understanding that. And then I asked them, okay, so when did you know that it doesn't fit? And all of them say the first month. So the problem was not that the team didn't fit. The problem was that the CEO didn't make the hard call, the hard decision. And many startups that I'm running into are actually in the same situation. So we think that, we will wait and it will become better. And it doesn't. So as a CEO, you need to make the hard calls. You need to make hard decisions. Making easy decisions is easy. Making hard decisions is hard. And this is where the CEO actually needs to make the decisions. So fundraising, who in the audience is actually raising capital? Excellent, good. So just a little bit of perspective. So a few months ago, I went into one of the large VCs in Israel and I sat up with one of the partners and I asked them, how long does it take you to decide if you like the entrepreneur or not? So the guy asked me, okay, do you want the right answers or do you want the real answers? And I say, I want the real answer. And then he said, before they sit down. So first impression takes seconds. And it doesn't matter if this is 5 seconds or 30 seconds, very, very short period of time. Which basically means that you have to start with the strongest point that you have at the beginning. Either the size of the problem you're trying to capture, or the team that you have, or the traction that you have, it doesn't matter what it is. Start with the strongest point, because by the time you'll get to that, it might not be relevant. Now, if you would ask investors what makes them to invest, you will get two answers, only two. We like the story, we like the CEO. This is it, nothing else. In particular, if you're early stage startup, if you're later stage, then it's about traction. It's about what you actually already made and as an impact. But at an early stage, we like the CEO, we like the story. So the CEO, therefore, should go by herself to raise capital, not the entire team, not with the CTO, just the CEO. So you would have the entire stage just for yourself. And then learn how to tell a story. If you don't know how to tell a story, then learn. It's very easy to learn. You take someone that can help you to learn and to tell a better story, and you practice. This is it. So if you actually implementing that, you increase your likelihood of raising capital probably by 5x, which is still small, right? So the reality is that, and there were, at least in the judges, there were one investor that I know, and he told me once, and hopefully he's on the audience that can confirm that he, as a partner at the venture capitals, gets to see good company once every 2 or 3 months. So most of the things that they are seeing, they don't like, right? They are saying no in general. They're saying 99% of the time no, and only 1% they're saying yes. So learn this practice and increase your likelihood of raising capital. So a few words about myself. There is a thinner version of me there, and I gain weight a little bit, actually quite a lot. I'm building startups. I'm an entrepreneur. I keep on building startups, and I'm trying to make bigger impact. And they're all focused on consumer services. They're all focused on, on creating value for consumers, which could be, saving time, saving money, empowering them, and so forth. So just a quick view of my startups. So Waze, we are all familiar with. Move It is like Waze, but for public transportation and actually answering the same question that Waze does. How do I get from here to wherever I want to go right now, but using public transportation? Now, the interesting part is that Moovit is actually growing faster than Waze at the time. So if you compare Waze at 4 years old versus Moovit at 4 years old, Moovit is actually growing faster. And so this is interesting. FeeX deals with the biggest secret in the world, financial fees. In the US alone, there are $600 billion of financial fees. And the scary part is that people don't even know that they're paying them. So if I would be, you know, asking 100 Americans how much fees you're paying on your retirement plan, if I will find one guy that knows, that's a lucky day. Now, the problem is that this is not a small amount of money, right? So if you think of 1% a year is not a big deal, 1% a year after a year after a year until you retire, it will end up as one-third of your lifetime saving. Now, this is a lot of money, and this is exactly what we're trying to solve. And the reason that I started that is that 2008 was a terrible year on the market, and in beginning of 2009, I get my annual statement on my retirement plan, and I noticed that I lost 20% on the market. And in addition, they charge me 1.5% for losing money, essentially, right? And I was upset, not because they took money that I didn't know, because I didn't know. And then I started to ask my friends how much fees they're paying, and none of my friends knew. And this is really the eureka moment that I realized that this is the next thing that I'm going to build after Waze. Rumor is a marketplace for non-refundable hotel reservation. So imagine a situation that you're actually you know, making travel plans and making hotel reservation, and then you change your plans and you get stuck with a reservation that you cannot use. So simply sell the reservation to someone else and recover some of the losses. In general, I like marketplaces because they increase efficiency in the market. So Zeek is another marketplace, a marketplace for store credit. So imagine that you return something to the store and you get the store credit that you can only use within the store. It turns out that 30% of those are never being used. Now, these 30% is 100 billion euros a year, 100 billion euros of real money that people are not using. So Zeek is simply a mobile marketplace that you can instantly upload for sale or buy them and increase the efficiency in the market. Angie deals with the frustrations of going to the mechanic. You know, if I will be taking my car to the mechanic, whatever they will say, I'll say okay, because I have no clue what's underneath the hood, right? If they will tell me that then, you know, you need to replace the carburetor in your car, then I'll say, okay, go ahead and replace the carburetor. Now, the only problem is that there is no carburetor in my car. They don't build cars with carburetors anymore, but we have no clue. So Angie is really an app running on the smartphones, connects to the car computer, doing the diagnostics for you, and then telling you in a language that you can understand what's wrong, and asking mechanics to quote to repair that. So all of a sudden empower the driver not only with the information and the knowledge, but also with the ability to do price comparison. Now, as it turns out, prices, at least in Israel, there are 40% differences in the quotes that you are getting for the same thing, for the exactly the same thing. And the reason that that we are paying more is that because we don't know. And so this is Angie. Fairfly deals with the biggest secret in the travel industry, and this is what happened to airfare after we book our flight. Now, no one knows because we never checked that, right? But before we make the reservation, we going online to maybe Kayak or different websites and compare prices and maybe monitor that over time, and we will see that prices are going up and down. They're actually going up and down based on the demand. And then we make the reservation, and then what happened? In reality, prices are keep on going up and down, but we don't do anything about it. So what Fairfly does, monitor your own itinerary, and if the price drops below cancellation fee of your own itinerary, then you're actually leaving money on the table, and you can rebook the same flight at a lower price. Now, it does work, and it does save you a lot of money, and every time that happens, you feel like you won the lottery, because that was money that you didn't even know that you're leaving on the table. And I have a couple of other concepts that I will be building next year and hopefully the year after that and so forth. And I'll keep on building those. As long as I'm running into problems that are worth solving, then hopefully I will keep on building solutions for them. And I would like to finish maybe with one more story. And I have here, you know, people approach me over during the break and say thank you that Waze helped them to, you know, avoid traffic jams. And there was one story, I don't know if that someone is here, that that there was a major accident and Waze actually saved them 6 hours of traffic jams coming from Slovenia or something like that. And there are always these stories. But about a year ago, I heard a story that actually was pretty amazing. So someone came to me and said, you saved my marriage. And I said, what? And he said, because of Waze, I don't need to argue anymore with my wife. And so you saved my marriage. And so it turns out that I'm a marriage consultant as well. And then the best story that I had actually came from my son. So I have 5 kids, I mentioned that. One of them is 18 years old, and he started to drive about a year ago. And some 6 months ago, I asked him to drive me to the airport. And he said, my phone is broken, I can't. And I said, what do you mean you can't? Here is the car, here are the keys to the car, drive me to the airport. And he said, I don't know how to get there. And I said, you know what? I'm gonna be in the car with you and I'll tell you how to get there. And then he said, and how would I come back? So we do lose orientation, but not logic. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Ďakujeme veľmi pekne. Môžeme prejsť k finálovej časti dnešného večera. So we can move to the final countdown of this beautiful and amazing afternoon, which turned actually into an evening. So we will now hand out all the prizes from all the categories. So I hope you guys, most of you won't win anything. Okay? Most of you guys will be disappointed. Most of you guys might be even sad. That's life. Enjoy it. But there's a couple of you who will be maybe surprised, maybe in tears, tears of joy. So we're looking forward. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite on the stage Mr. Petr Gažík, the CEO of O2, who will give out the award for Society Group. Warm welcome and a great round of applause. Mr. Petr Gažík. Dobrý večer, Peter. Nech sa páči. Peter, I have the envelope.
Thank you.
So, please, announce the winner in the category of society.
What's he doing playing with the computer in the backstage?
Something went wrong. I don't know what.
So, the winner of the category society is STEMI.
Samozrejme, víťazov pozývame sem na hlavné pódium celý tým, nie len jedného, ale všetci. All the guys from STEMI, I can see you. Come up to the stage right now, as soon as possible. everybody from the team. So these are the winners for the category Society STEMI. Dobrý večer. Dobrý večer. Srdečná gratulácia. Srdečná gratulácia, pán doktor. Otec syn, však? To som si aj myslel. Dobrý večer. Dobrý večer. Gratulujeme. No, nech sa páči, tak Martin. Viem to preto, lebo máš to napísané na hrudi. Po slovensky? Záleží, ako to cítiš. Vnútorne.
So, as STEMI has five letters, I would like to say five things. First of all, we would like to thank all paramedics and doctors using our application in everyday clinical practice. Number two, we would like to thank digital agency Helefant, which really helped us in the beginnings to kickstart our application. Number three, we would like to thank, of course, you. We would like to thank number four. I would like to thank our whole team, who is working very hard for very little or no money. And number four, five. Okay, it will be six. Sorry. So maybe our potential investor, if there is any angel that would like to save lives with us, get in touch. And future investor. And number six, I would like to thank CEO of this whole world and probably the biggest venture capitalist ever, our God. Thank you.
Ďakujeme veľmi pekne, thank you very much. STEMI, the winners of the category Society. For the next category tonight, Art and Design. Please, welcome on stage Mr. Marek Masaryk from KPMG, who will give out the award in the Art and Design category. Prichádza Marek Masaryk. Zdravím vás, príjemný, dobrý večer. Nech sa páči, stage is yours. I got the envelope. Here you are.
Čože? Good evening, everyone. Together with my colleagues, we are really happy to be here today and really happy to discover who is the winner in the category Art and Design. And I must say that each of these projects were really excellent, really inspiring and innovating. And we are proud that such a smart people are here in Slovakia.
Thank you.
And the winner is Maguss.
Kde ste boli? Už ste boli v bare, však? No, ale teraz vás čaká tvrdá práca, akože, hej, ozdoby a ornamenty a ceny. Kto bude rozprávať?
Ja, hej?
Môžem aj ja?
Kľudne.
Nie, nech sa páči.
In English. All right, so I haven't really prepared anything, and I'm sorry for that, because this is kind of a surprise for us. But I'm very happy that I had the chance to be here, go through this very stressful event, and I'm really thankful that you all came and watched it, and also, of course, to the organizers that made this happen. And I'm very thankful for winning the category.
Ďakujeme veľmi pekne. Thank you very much. Maguss. A kategória Art and Design. Dámy a páni, ladies and gentlemen, we're moving forward to the next category. Please welcome Mr. Peter Matúš, a board member of Tatra Banka, who will give out the award in a digital category. Zdravím vás. Dobrý večer. Good evening. Nech sa páči, vlastne, this is your envelope.
Thank you.
A povedzte nám samozrejme pekne do mikrofónu.
Okay. Good evening. The winner of the category digital is Age and Balance.
Yeah. Agent Balance, Pokeceli team Sam v kategórii Digital Agent Balance. Gratulujeme.
Thank you so much. This is the best moment in my professional career. I'm so happy. I don't know how much happier I could get. I love you guys.
Nikto z vás? Stačí takto? No.
Just to thanks Neulogy to picking up Agent Balance. Thanks.
Maybe one more thing. Thanks our great families for supporting us from the beginning, you know. The times were not always very easy, so thank you very much.
Ďakujeme veľmi pekne, thank you very much. Máme kategóriu Digital za sebou. The category Digital is over, and this is going to be actually the last category tonight. So please welcome on stage Mr. Bill Shee, the CEO of Huawei Slovakia, who will give out the award for Science category. Good evening. Sorry. There's some euros inside.
The winner for the science is MultiplexDX.
As a scientist, I have been preparing speech for years for Nobel Prize. However, this is again great prize. Yeah. But continue with Nobel Prize speech. We normally thanks wives. And you would be surprised, but my wife is now watching online in the United States. And I promised her if I win, I will send the warmest greetings to the United States right now. So Marina, I'm very happy to win, and I hope you're happy with me. And please kiss all my three sons, and I hope that they will become like their dad, MultiplexDX scientists. And we have another member in the United States, our another co-founder, Vladimir Wolf, and this is as much his prize as ours. And thank you, Vladimir, for being biggest supporter and great partner.
Okay, I won't be singing, don't be afraid. I'd like to thank everybody that believes in us, in our idea, because this gives us energy to go forward and to believe in our solution, in the problem that we are trying to go to really save lives. So thank you to everybody, to Neulogy to organize this, to the jury to believe in us, to our families to support us, and to Saifa to, of course, make the evening even funnier. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I always ask for it. Thank you. And I'll deserve it. Thank you. Just before the announcement of all these beautiful winners, I forgot to tell you guys what they are actually given. So the prize, each finalist, hey, you guys listen carefully, gets small business security pack 10 from Asset worth 6,000 euros each. Each category winner gets 2,500 euros cash prize, accounting and advisory services from BDO, complex HR consulting services from Synergie, and the science category winner gets legal services from Majernik and Mihalikova law firm. And the overall winner of the sixth startup awards gets on top of all these prizes, legal services from Taylor Wessing, 10,000 euros cash prize, so he's inviting all of you guys, and $35,000 grant from the Slovak-American Foundation's U.S. Connections Program. Nice. Please, now, welcome on stage Ms. Mary McPherson from the Slovak-American Foundation, who will announce the overall winner of Startup Awards 2016. So we actually met at the beginning. We met.
It was good for me.
It was very good for me as well. And now we meet at the end. Mm-hmm. It must be fate.
It must be.
Must be. So I have the envelope, and please tell us the overall winner.
Well, I will, and I mean, I don't know, as none of us knew, but I think we all would want to applaud everyone who participated tonight and who's on the stage tonight and in the wings and in the audience. So let's do that. Applaud yourself. And the overall winner is MultiplexDX.
MultiplexDX, the overall winner of the 6th annual Startup Awards, with a check of $35,000. Nice.
I don't know what to say. I don't know, this is better than Nobel Prize. You know, and because we won this, now we will thank the most important part of our success, and that's actually Neulogy Ventures and Neulogy itself. Without you, we wouldn't be standing here, and I don't know how grateful I am for all your support. And this will be definitely used for very great purpose. We will try to increase our marketing in the United States. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And of course, the prize. And one last thing I would like to do, and I know it looks very good on TV. They did it on the Oscars just a couple of years ago. Can we guys just get more together and we'll make a couple of selfies, you know, for my Instagram? Is it? You can do a picture as well. I mean, is it possible that you guys, yeah, okay. I mean, I know there's a lot of envy now and everything, you know, but let's come together, okay? Smile more. And I mean, you can do the same thing if you're interested. I can hold it for you. Okay? Your phone died. I'm very sorry. It must be a funeral, right? Mm. Nice! Okay, very nice. Now, it's my turn. Just a second, okay. Smile, right here, okay. It's the iPhone 8. Very nice. Anybody else for a selfie? Come on. Come on. See? Selfie time, I love it. And hold the award, you know. Okay, hold the award like, shh. Yeah, that's it. Hold it, okay. Very nice. Okay. Anybody else? Or the evening is over? Okay. No way. Very nice. Okay, so, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. It was a great pleasure and an honor to be here in Istropolis. This is an old communist building, but actually now it was filled with great ideas, and I hope you guys, all of you, are successful. Because successful people are... I don't have any... I mean, like... like a real good thought at the end, you know? So I'm just making it up as we go along. So thank you very much. Enjoy the evening and see you next year at the 7th Annual Startup Awards. It's over. Thank you very much. And a great applause for these guys. Thank you very much. Dovidenia, dobru noc. Ďakujeme.